Cambridge IGCSE Biology Majun 2020 Paper 42 Part 2 Question 3. Cheetahs, Acinonyx gibbatus are carnivores found in the dry grasslands and woodlands of southern Africa. Cheetahs hunt for food during the day. They eat deer and antelope. The cheetah is the fastest mammal on land but can only run at high speed, sprint over a short distance. Its hunting strategy is to creep up on prey and then sprint to catch them. Figure 3.1 is a photograph of a cheetah in its natural habitat. Part A suggests how these adaptive features enable cheetahs to survive in their natural environment. Fur coloring. We can see dark spots on its fur. It helps to be camouflaged so that they are not easily seen by prey when creeping up on them. Streamlined body shape. We can already see from their body shape that they are very flexible and agile. This feature helps them to run fast. Make sure you write points related to the given information. You can write other points as long as they make sense and are clear on the diagram since you're not required to memorize some features of a cheetah. Part B. The king cheetah is a rare variety of A. gibbatus that has inherited striped fur markings. Figure 3.2 shows a cheetah with spots and a king cheetah. Cheetah with spots and king cheetah. Define the term inheritance. Definition of inheritance is transmission of genetic information from generation to generation. Figure 3.3 shows a pedigree diagram of a population of cheetahs. Deduce the genotype of cheetah 11. Alright, the circle stands for a female and the square stands for a male. The shaded ones are king cheetahs and the others are cheetahs with spots. Cheetah 11 is here. It's a female king cheetah. Even though its parents are both cheetahs with spots, it's a king cheetah, meaning that its parents are carriers of alleles of king cheetah. The alleles of king cheetah are recessive because it didn't show its traits in cheetahs 3 and 4. Let's choose letter C to represent an allele of a cheetah. In this case, it should be two small letters of C since it represents two recessive alleles of a king cheetah. Predict the probability of cheetah 14 being a king cheetah. Now we know that cheetahs 3 and 4 are carriers of alleles of king cheetah, small c, and their genotypes are CC. So if two heterozygous species produce an offspring, there is a 25% chance of producing a homozygous recessive species. Describe how a breeder could determine the genotype of cheetah 17. While we can go through a DNA testing to determine its genotype, or we can perform a test cross. Test cross is breeding with a homozygous recessive, in this question, the king cheetah. If any of the offspring of the test cross are king cheetahs, it means that cheetah 17 is heterozygous and carries a recessive allele. If not, it means that it's a homozygous dominant. When the king cheetah was first discovered, it was thought that it was a new species. Pedigree diagrams of cheetahs proved it was not a new species. Suggest one type of evidence other than pedigree diagrams that can be used to determine how closely related organisms are. Other than knowing that they are the same species by the fact that they can reproduce together, we can know it by comparing their morphology or anatomy. Basically by observing their physical features. Also, we can compare their DNA sequences, as species that are closely related will have the least difference between their sequences. Part C. Cheetahs are at risk of becoming endangered. Suggest why the cheetah is at risk of becoming endangered. Sadly, cheetahs are endangered animals, and there are many reasons for that. Firstly, it's due to humans hunting them down and reducing their numbers. They're usually hunted for furs. Also, it may be due to lack of food or prey, which could also be due to human hunting various animals. Then it may be due to environmental factors such as pollution and getting infected by diseases. If there is a natural disaster, they may lose their natural habitats, and furthermore, some may not be getting adapted to climate change these days. We have more than enough points, but it's good to memorize all of them since this can be asked in paper 2 or just asked in a different way. Describe how species like the cheetah can be conserved. First, it's by providing them safe shelters like national parks. In this way, they won't be hunted down all the time and will be protected from urbanization as well. It will help to monitor their numbers too. They can also go through captive breeding programs, which allows them to reproduce and increase in number. One other important thing to do is to prevent hunting and increase awareness of how endangered they are to the local people in the area. Question 4. Some crop farmers use herbicides on their fields. Figure 4.1 shows a farmer spraying a rice crop with herbicides. Part A. Herbicides kill weeds. Explain why farmers use herbicides. Herbicides kill weeds, which means there will be less competition for the rice crops to grow. This will increase the crop production. Part B. Fields of crop plants were sprayed with two herbicides. A farmer measured the concentration of the two herbicides A and B in a lake near the fields. The water in the lake was sampled at intervals for 2 weeks. Figure 4.2 shows the results. When the farmer first sprayed the herbicides, there was a high concentration of it in the nearby lake. But after a few days, it slowly started to decrease for both herbicides A and B. Compare the concentrations of herbicide A and herbicide B in the lake. Use the information in Figure 4.2 to support your answer. Comparing is a popular question in biology. You need to know how to answer this question. First, talk about the overall trend. As I just mentioned, the concentration of both herbicides decreased over time. Then compare those two by stating which one is higher. Herbicide A has a higher concentration than B throughout the measured readings. Now write some interesting points, like when they have reached zero concentration. The concentration of herbicide A became zero after 14 days, and herbicide B became zero after 7 days. We also need to include some comparative data, so write about the initial concentration. It started from 0.128 mg per kg for herbicide B and 0.18 mg per kg for herbicide A. You must include the units. You can also compare the gradient of each graph. Graph for herbicide A is steeper than B in the beginning. I have written 5 points, so if you manage to write all of this in your exam, you'll be able to get full marks. Suggest how herbicides damage ecosystems in a lake. Herbicides were used to kill weeds, so they're going to kill the water plants or the algae in the lake. Then there will be lack of food for herbivores and they may reduce in numbers as well. This is going to affect the food web and reduce biodiversity. Also, if the organisms are exposed to herbicides for a long period of time, the toxic substances of herbicides will accumulate in their bodies, called bioaccumulation, causing poisoning and death afterwards. Part C. Herbicide A is a synthetic plant hormone called 2,4-D that selectively kills dicotyledonous plants only. Stay two features that distinguish leaves of dicotyledonous plants from leaves of monocotyledonous plants. This is a common question. Dicotyledons have branched veins and broad leaves, but monocotyledons have parallel veins and narrow leaves. Dicotyledons have something called a petiole, shown here. State the name of a natural plant hormone that stimulates cell elongation. We usually have a whole page in our textbook dedicated on this. It's called an auxin. Herbicide B is a chemical that prevents the uptake of magnesium ions. Suggest how herbicide B kills plants. We just need to write what happens if plants cannot take magnesium ions. Magnesiums are essential in making chlorophyll, so without magnesium ions, there won't be any chlorophyll. And without chlorophyll, plants will not be able to trap sunlight. Then naturally, there won't be photosynthesis. Question 5. The Galapagos Islands are a group of small islands in the Pacific Ocean. In 1839, Charles Darwin published a book that described differences in a family of birds called finches. Each species of Galapagos finch had a different diet, a different beak shape, as shown in Figure 5.1. Part A. State the genus name for the Galapagos finches shown in Figure 5.1. These words, written in italics, stand for genus and species, so this is the genus. Part B. Galapagos finches share a common ancestor. Suggest how Galapagos finches have evolved different-shaped beaks. We don't have to explain how the beaks differ from each other and all that, we actually just need to explain why they have evolved different-shaped beaks. Well, the answer is that natural selection has occurred and the birds have evolved different-shaped beaks. Now, just explain what natural selection is, and the answer for this question is pretty much fixed, so you need to memorize this whole thing. Firstly, there was variation in beak shapes. For example, some were born with sharp beaks and some with round beaks. This may be due to mutation in their genes, so they were born with different beaks from the rest of the species. Then somehow, it's possible that those birds with unique beak shape began to find food better and survive better, reproducing offspring with beaks like them. The offspring would carry the alleles of beaks with advantage and survive, being able to continue this over many generations and evolving different shaped beaks. So when you want to answer questions about natural selection, first state that there is a variation in whatever physical feature the question talks about and that it is due to mutation. Then state that this physical feature could have given this organism an advantage to find food and survive better than others. The next point is that it reproduced offspring and passed on their alleles and continued over many generations. This is what the natural selection is about, and this is the format that you must follow. So just apply this according to the question like how I did. Part A. Figure 6.1 is a diagram showing some parts of a plant. The circle shows a magnified cross-section of part of the stem. Lots of parts are labeled from A to M. Table 6.1 contains statements about the functions of some of the structures in Figure 6.1. Complete the table by stating the name of the structure, identifying the letter that labels that structure. Function: provide support to the stem. It's a part of a stem, specifically xylem. Xylem is the inner part of this tablet-shaped things. Letter L. Protects flower bud. This is the flower bud. It's being supported by this G. It's called a sepal. Produces glucose. Glucose is a product of photosynthesis, and photosynthesis occurs in leaves. So glucose is produced at H, the leaves. Produces pollen. Think about where you can spot pollen from a flower. There are anthers where they are produced, so the answer is B, anther. Delivers male nuclei to the site of fertilization. Male nuclei is within the pollen, and this is the site of fertilization, so to bring it down here, it needs to be transported through this, the pollen tube, D. State one letter from Figure 6.1 that identifies a structure that contains a haploid nucleus. A haploid nucleus is inside the pollen, so think about where the pollen can be in a flower. It can be at B, the anther, where it is produced, or it can be at D, the pollen tube, where it is transported, or it can be at F, inside the ovule. You just need to write one. State the name of the process that describes the transport of sucrose in a plant. Transport of sucrose is called translocation. If it's a transport of water, it's called transpiration. Memorize both terms together. State one letter from Figure 6.1 that is a structure that is an example of a source for sucrose transport. Sucrose is made of glucose and fructose, and glucose is produced in leaves. So the source of sucrose is H, the leaves. Part B. In addition to sucrose, amino acids are also transported in plants. State the name of a mineral ion that becomes part of an amino acid. The mineral ions are the ones that can be found in soil and are taken up by roots, so the answer is nitrate ions. State the name of the structures inside cells that assemble amino acids into proteins. What makes amino acids into proteins? You can write ribosomes or rough endoplasmic reticulum. Both assemble amino acids into proteins. State the name of the group of molecules that are made of proteins and act as catalysts. A bit of a hint, this is a biology paper, so think of biological catalysts. They are enzymes, and yeah, they are made of proteins. I hope and believe all of you who have watched this video will do well in your exams. That's it for this video. Thank you for watching, and please subscribe, like, and comment to support me. Stay safe, and God bless you guys. Bye!